Hello Builders, I'm Martin and this is Make Your Own Sound, the channel in which we are talking about how to create your own sound mixing console, episode 7. In the previous two episodes we talked about how to optimize Windows 7 and Windows 10 for live sound. And before that we downloaded and set up the program called Software Audio Console for the first time. In the next few episodes we'll take a closer look at the software and learn to tinker with its many features. In this episode specifically, I will show you the channel layout, what resides where, and how you can move things around for more convenience. Let's go! I will now assume that you've already downloaded the demo version of SAC. If you follow the series, we did that in episode 4, and if you don't, I'll leave a link for the software in the description. Go there, download it, install it, and come back here. Done? Okay, now it's time to start SAC. I have this shortcut on my desktop. If this is the first time you start this program, it will probably look like this. But it may look in several different ways. Simply put, SAC has different elements to its UI, all of which you can find in the View menu. You can hide them by clicking on these blue dashes on each window. You can make them appear again from here. Or you can put different ones. You can rearrange them. And you can save different configurations on the F keys of your keyboard. I've saved several. This is my F1 key, this is my F2 key, this is my F3 key, and so on. If you want to create your own F key configurations and make sure they stick after you restart the program, here's how you do it. Choose some panels and arrange them the way you want. Then make sure to click on the panel you want to be active when you recall your F key. It will be remembered also. When you're ready to save, hold the Shift key and press one of the F keys on your keyboard. Let's say you want this exact configuration to be saved on your F5 key. Hold Shift and press F5. Then click OK and it is saved. Now you can bring some other panel and arrange things differently. I'll save this on my F6 key. I'll hold Shift and press F6. Then click OK. Now we have two different configurations we can immediately recall with the press of a button. If I press F5, I get this. And if I press F6, I get this. F5, F6. There's one more important thing to remember. If I now shut down the program and start it again, the two configurations that I just saved will be lost. If I want the software to remember them permanently, I'll have to do the following. I'll go to File, then F key File, and select Save Default. Then click OK. Now everything's saved and we can stop and start the program as many times as we want. Our F5 and F6 configurations will be remembered. And every time you make a new configuration, don't forget to do the same thing. That's it. These are the basics. As you may have noticed, when you save an F key, you have four options here. But I will save them for a future video when they will make more sense. Now let's go back to the channel layout of this virtual mixing software, which is best represented by this window, which is called the Full Mixer in the View menu, or by this window, which is called the Zoom Mixer in the View menu. As you can see, this thing looks almost like a regular mixing console with all the faders, the mutes, the solos, and so on. And if you look at the Zoom Mixer, it looks even more like an analog mixing console. Let me show you a trick. If you have this mixer on your screen, click and hold your right mouse button. Then your cursor becomes an arrow pointing up and down. Now just move your mouse up and you start to climb your way to the channel settings. Here are the auto signs. Here are the aux sends. Here are the compressors and the gates. Here are the equalizers. And so on. You can stop at any time. But let's go back down. I will show you another trick. Let's reduce this window to just one channel and move it over here. And let's bring the full mixer. Now the two mixers are connected. As you can see, if I select a channel on this mixer, it automatically appears on the other one. Look at the numbers right here. Now this is channel 1. Now it's channel 5. And now it's 10. Next, pay attention to these little boxes with different colors and different names on them. Here's what they mean. This is the input section in the attenuator. This is the EQ. This is the dynamics section. This is the effect section for the VST plugins. These are the auxes. And this is the output assign section. Now, if I choose a channel, let's say channel 1, and if I press on some of those boxes, the corresponding section will appear in the zoom mixer on the left. Here they are, the output assigns, the auxes, the dynamics, the EQ, and so on. Let's say I want to go to channel 5 and turn on the compressor. I'll select channel 5, click on dynamics, and turn the compressor on here. Now, I personally don't like to work this way, but it's one way to do things, so if it fits your style, you can play with it. I actually prefer something like this. This is the preset I've saved on my F1 key. I like to work with this guy. This is the wide mixer, and it gives you all the controls for each selected channel in one place, just like in many hardware digital consoles. If I select channel 5, I can see all of its settings, like the compressor that we turned on just a moment ago. And if I bring up the fader, it will move in the wide mixer also. Now, as you can see, if I use a screen with a full HD resolution and arrange things this way with the wide mixer on the left, I can fit only 26 mixing channels right here. Lately, I try to use a different configuration, like this one. These two things overlap a bit, but I can still see all the important stuff right here, and now I can fit 49 channels in one screen. And all of this is if you work with just one full HD monitor. If you have a bigger screen with greater resolution or multiple screens, things get better and you can throw things around. Anyway, let's go back to learning about the channel layout in SAC and see which is where. Your front of house mixer has 120 input channels, 6 aux returns, 16 subgroups and 8 main outputs. That makes a total of 150 channels. But you can't see them all at once because they cannot fit on your screen. Wait, let me try to show you. If we zoom way out, this is how the whole mixer would look like if it could fit on your screen. These are the 120 input channels. These are the aux returns. These are the subgroups. And these are the main outputs. Now we are gonna learn 4 things. How to give the channels names, how to give the channels colors, how to switch quickly from inputs to auxes to outputs, and finally, how to rearrange your channels so they can fit best your project. Let's start with the names, but first, let's give ourselves some context. Today, we'll be working with a small imaginary band consisting of a vocalist, a guitar player, a bass player, and a drummer. So, what inputs will we have? A mic for the vocalist and another for the guitar amplifier. The bass will go through a DI and will go simple on the drums with one mic for the kick and one for the snare. We'll have just one mic for the toms and one more for the floor. We'll put a mic on the hi-hat and 2 more for overheads. That's it! Now let's go back to our software and prepare a project for this band. There are 2 ways of naming channels. If you want to name just a single channel, hold Shift on your keyboard and click on this white label. You'll see a small window where you can write the name. I'll write Vocal and then I'll press Enter. And here it is. The name Vocal appeared on channel number 1. Okay, but what if I wanted to name a bunch of channels one after the other without clicking on each individual channel? Now that I know what my channels will be, I'll do the following. This time I will hold Ctrl on my keyboard and I'll click on a channel. This will be my guitar channel. I'll write Guitar and press Enter. As you can see, channel 2 got its name and another window appeared automatically for the next channel. I will type Bass and hit Enter again. Then I'll repeat the process for the rest of my channels. Kick, snare, toms, floor, hi-hat, left overhead and right overhead. When I'm done, I can simply hit Escape or close this window with a little blue dash over here. Now, before I continue, I want to do one more thing. I don't like that the names of the channels are all stuck on the top of these white labels. So, I'll go to the mixer menu, I'll select full meter label position, and here I can choose if I want the names to appear on the top, in the center, or on the bottom. I personally like my names to be in the center, so I'll choose center. And here they are. Now, when this is done, I'll want to give my channels some color. Choose a channel, hold Alt on your keyboard, and right-click on the channel. Then, in this menu, select Set Channel Label Color, and here you can choose one of those 16 colors. I'll make my vocal channel red. Then, I'll make my guitar channel green, and my bass is gonna be blue. Then I want all the drums to be yellow. I can give them colors one by one, or I can color them all at once. So now we'll see how to select multiple channels. It's actually very easy. You can click on the channel's numbers like this, and now the selected channels are in black. Or you can click and drag to select multiple channels like this. You can also subtract channels by clicking on them once again, like this. And if you want to terminate your selection, just click somewhere on the numbers with your right mouse button and the selection will disappear. This will come in handy for so many things later. But first, let's color our drums yellow. I'll select all of them in one move by clicking and dragging. Then I'll hold Alt and right-click on any of the selected channels. Then click here and select a yellow color. Next, I'll remove the selection by right-clicking somewhere up here. And that's it. All of the drum channels are now yellow. Now, I'll throw a tip about the colors. As you may have noticed, you have only 16 colors to choose from and it seems like they're fixed. But that's not exactly the case. You actually have 16 small color boxes, but if you don't like the colors here, you're able to change them. Just go to Options and then Color Setup. Now you can click on each one of the 16 boxes and change the color with whichever you want. Next, let's look at the channels and see what else can we do with them. First, I will click on channel 3 and I want to draw your attention to these red lines here. They indicate which channel is currently selected. If I click on channel 2, they move there. The same with channel 4. Now, you can select channels by just clicking on them, or you can scroll through channels with the wheel of your mouse, forwards and backwards. Or you can also scroll through channels with the arrows on your keyboard. Right arrow to the right, and left arrow to the left. But what if you wanted to go to your aux returns, or your groups, or your master fader? As you remember, they are on the opposite end of that big pile of channels. Well, you can do it by just scrolling through all the 120 channels. And scroll, and scroll, and here we are. We'll do what we came here to do, and then scroll back, and back, and back to the beginning. It's doable, but it's so slow and inconvenient. Fortunately, there are better ways. First, there are these three letters over here. We used them for a little bit in episode 4, and now we'll do it again. The I is for inputs, the R is for returns, and the O is for outputs. So, no matter where I am in the mixer, if I press the R, I will immediately go to the first of the aux returns. And here it is. And if I press the O, it will transport me to the first channel of the output section. Right here. Then, if I want to go back to my input channels, I will press the I, and here I am, at the first input channel. And you could do the same thing using the tab button on your keyboard. Every time you press tab, it cycles through the three letters. For example, now I'm at the input section. If I press tab, I'll go to the auxes. If I press it again, it will take me to the outputs. And if I press it again, I'll go back to the inputs, and so on. So far, so good. During a live performance, you could work with your input channels. Then, for a moment, you could go and tinker something with the auxes or with the groups, and go back to the inputs again. It's like the layers of many hardware digital consoles. But may I suggest something different, which to me is way better option. Also, we didn't finish the setup for our band, so let's do that. We set up the input channels, but it's a good idea to have some effects and maybe a subgroup for the drums. So let's go and prepare them. I will press my tab key, which will take me to the aux returns. For my small band, I will not need all six of them. I'll use a delay and a reverb for the vocals and another reverb for the band. So I'll use the first three auxes and I'll give them names. This will be my delay, this will be my vocal reverb, and this will be the reverb for the rest of the band. Also, I will use output 9, which is actually the first subgroup channel, and make a subgroup for the drums out of it. I will call it drums. And also, all of my mix will finally go through my master fader, which is this one right here. I will simply call it master. Okay, it could work, but it's a little bit messy. The total amount of faders I want to use for this session is 15, and it would be great if they were all in one place and I could forget about the rest 135 channels I don't need to use right now. And yes, actually I can do that, because all of the channels in this software can be rearranged. Let me show you. There are two ways, and both of them involve the button shift on the keyboard. First, I don't like that my three auxes, my subgroup and my master fader are separated. I want them all packed in one place. So I'll hold the shift button, I'll click up here on the channel I want to move and drag it right here in front of the auxes. Then I'll hold shift again and drag the master fader right here. And it is done. Now all the things I need are packed right next to each other. The next thing I wanna do is take these 5 channels and transport them to the beginning of the console right next to my input channels. But if I do it the way I just showed you, I'll have to drag them all the way through the rest 110 channels. And that won't be very elegant. So I'll use the other way. You can think of it as some kind of teleportation. I'll select all these 5 channels, then I'll click on the I button to instantly go to the beginning of the console where the input channels are. Then I'll hold shift and click on the place where I want to put them. And here they are. It's that simple. Just select the channel, go wherever you want to place it, hold shift and click on that place. The channel moves and all the other channels automatically rearrange. Just don't forget to remove the selection with your right mouse button after you're finished. Now we have all the input channels, the drum group, the three aux returns for the effects, and the master fader all in one place. That way we created a compact mixing console with only 15 channels that we can see all at once and can interact with quick and easy. And if we need another channel of any kind, we can bring it here. You already know how to do it. And finally, did you notice we just created a project in our software? And we may want to go back to it, so I think it's a really good idea to save what we did today in order to not lose it the moment we shut down the program. I can press Ctrl and S on my keyboard, which is the universal combination for save on PC, or I can go to File and click on Save and Update Mix Session. Then I'll have to choose where I want to save my session. SAC actually has a folder just for that, and I suggest we use it. We are currently in it, but nevertheless I'll show you where its location is so that you know. I'll navigate to the C drive, then SAC demo, and here you will find this folder called mix. That's what we are looking for. Enter the mix folder, and now it's a good idea to create a new folder for every new project we make. This is important for the scenes functionality, but we'll talk about that in the future. So just take my advice and create a separate folder for this new project. I'll call mine 4-member band. Then I'll go into this folder and I'll save the actual project here. I'll give it the same name, 4-member band, and I'll click save. And it's done. Now, if I want to open this session again, I can go to File, Open Mix Session, and then open this file. Or I can go to File, click on Recent Mix Session File List, and it's already here waiting for me. I can click on the name of the session I want to open, and here it is. ready for mixing. Well, that's it for this video, and in the next one we'll take a closer look at the white mixer. So, see you there, and thank you for watching. Oh, you're still here? Great! There are a few more important things I need to mention, like the video you just watched is part of a series and all the episodes are connected. So, if you stumbled on this episode by accident and you wasn't sure what exactly I was talking about, you can go and watch the previous episodes, or at least the first episode over there, which explains the idea of the whole endeavor. And I'll be very happy if you liked the video. It's part of one big tutorial about how to build your own sound mixing console. So if you did, please consider clicking on the like button. And if you find this topic interesting or useful, you may subscribe and click on the bell so you'll be notified when I'm ready with the next video. And I know there are people out there who do what I do and know more than me. So, if you know something that I don't, or have ideas for new episodes, please tell me. I'll be happy to also learn from you.